Back to the Hearthstone World Championships. We just finished up our group stages, and the battlefield is a little different from how we started yesterday. Where are we sitting now?
That's right. Well, the group stages aren't completely finished yet, but we finished each first match, which determines who goes into the winner's bracket and then who goes into the loser's bracket. And what that means is we play a double elimination group. You have to lose twice before you're finally out of the BlizzCon running, but we still have an opportunity for each player. They're still alive in the tournament. We had players advance to the winners. That was Tice, Kranich, Oskaka, and Pingping Ho. And over on the lower bracket, we just saw that a lot of players, they suffered a little bit, but you know, players like Life Coach and Purple, I definitely think they can turn it around.
I think so too. Do you have any insight into what they've been doing these past couple days? I think they've just been holed up practicing, right?
Well, some of them have. A few of them have just been clearing their mind and exploring a little bit of the Southern California area. The weather here is absolutely phenomenal.
It's beautiful, guys.
It's great. It's perfect weather to just be out in t-shirt and jeans or even shorts. And so some people have chosen to go for the beach. They've decided to hang out and just, you know, take a nice walk around downtown, go shopping for stuff. And it's sometimes that helps a little bit more than practicing nonstop, because you need to clear your mind, and because Hearthstone is so cerebral, everything's in your head, you've practiced so many hours and you know your strategy already, you might overthink it. In fact, that's what Nias just told me. He said that he thinks that he may have just like overcomplicated things by taking too long on his turns, and as a result may have given up a series that was his.
Well, that sounds pretty rough. I do hope the players, as they're enjoying themselves, are taking some time to watch the games today, because we did see a lot of really creative stuff from some of the players today.
Yeah, that's right. We've seen Rogue succeed. Even though it didn't win every game, it won 2 out of 3 games, enough for Oskaka and Hotform, who did end up advancing to the winner bracket. We saw both these Rogue players go through. Another unique thing is the Shamans also have won as well. We saw players like Pingping Ho yesterday was able to take his series, calling himself the Shaman God. And earlier today, we also see Dai Meng qualify for the winner's bracket portion, playing a Mech Shaman. And these are two classes that people wrote off saying it's literally unplayable. And then here's also another wild card, is that Tice is the only player to bring Priest. And like, you know, no one plays Priest at all, and he's also in the winner's bracket. So something different is working, and that's what makes it really exciting.
Yeah, I can't wait to see how these next matches pan out. We have the start of our lower bracket coming up very soon. Don't go anywhere. It's going to be up next.
Ja versus No Tomorrow.
All right. Well, the first elimination matches of the tournament are underway. This is, I guess, not the best thing to say, but it's my favorite part of the tournament. It's where you really see people bring their everything, bring their emotions to the table, and there's more of a dynamic than just the Hearthstone play at work.
Yeah, I mean, while neither of these players want to go home, both these players also really want to go and play on the BlizzCon stage. Mm-hmm. It is, you know, the pinnacle of Hearthstone, and neither of these players want to see that dream cut short here.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course, here we got Amaz, Kibler, and myself. I'm Crip, and we will lead the elimination rounds for you guys. Of course, these players will all still be at BlizzCon if you do want to hang out with them, if you guys want to meet them, get a signature, get your mouse pad signed. They will all be there, so you BlizzCon fans, you guys won't be missing out on the players, even if unfortunate things happen to them. And unfortunate things will have to happen to at least half of them.
You made it sound so much more terrible than it actually is.
Okay. I mean, depending on your perspective, it could be fate worse than death. Well, probably not death, but.
Okay. Well, it definitely does. It's not that pleasant if you have to go to an event and you can't play in it. But right. So that's why they have to give it all the best right now.
That's
this
right.
Is do or die moment. I mean,
these players took their losses. No Tomorrow was yesterday. He lost the first match of
Tice.
Tice.
He lost.
And then Jab lost a very close match earlier today.
Indeed,
so
he did.
I have to imagine that Jab's coming into this really, really hungry for you know, the win that he may have felt like just slipped through his fingers.
One aspect that I kind of talked to Hoffman about yesterday is it feels like if you're going to lose a game, you want to lose it on the first day. Because if you play on the second day, you have to factor in a little bit of the fatigue element. Mm-hmm. Now, okay. Hearthstone is, you know, it's a fun game. It doesn't when you play it at home, it doesn't require you to be fully 100% in the zone and awake. Oh. But when it comes to very important high-level tournament play, you know, players are getting like 10, 12 hours rest. You know, they're really being as rested and as calm as possible. So having to play your second match after losing one on the same day can have an element of stress.
I mean, Hearthstone is a game that it is not, you know, physically exhausting, but it's certainly mentally exhausting.
Mm-hmm.
And even just sitting and playing, you know, a match and being sort of tensed and stressed out and in the zone in focus, you can, you know, start to have even just your back hurting at the end of the day. It can sound kind of ridiculous to say, but you know, Jab had the very first match of the day today, mm-hmm. and he has had to wait since then to sort of think through all of his turns and everything. And it's possible that he is sort of in that spot where he maybe experience a little bit of fatigue.
Well, so here's the match. No Tomorrow is going to coin out the redemption here just to pump up the Secret Keeper to crank up the pressure a little bit. And also, his turn 4 play was, you know, it wasn't really existent, right? You're not going to consecrate nothing. Mm-hmm. So I do like that play.
Yeah, I mean, it's a case where your hand is bad enough that you have to go all in, and it's not usually something you see on turn 2, but if you're going to see it, this deck is one that does bring it to the table.
Mm-hmm.
And this the redemption will bring back the Secret Keeper here. Not necessarily the best thing to get that redemption triggered on, but not terrible either. Minibot, probably the best thing.
Yeah,
but
that actually makes that second redemption much better.
Yeah, now it now gives No Tomorrow a play on curve here using all of his mana.
This is a pretty interesting aspect. I feel like double redemption, it wasn't that popular. It wasn't unheard of, but it wasn't that popular. And now we're actually seeing another player from the Asia region bring this. Maybe over there it is in fact very popular.
Yeah, it was deemed one of the weaker secrets compared to Avenge and like Noble Sacrifice. They usually affect the board a little bit more. But then if you bring two, it does make it so that if you draw one of them and you draw for perhaps Mysterious Challenger in the late game, that it does pull that out and has more, you know, effect.
You might have to equality here.
I mean, this is definitely a spot where that redemption, I think No Tomorrow would have been much happier if it were Repentance.
Mm-hmm.
If he was able to reduce the health of that bear to one, the lot as you get through here, he may be forced to use that equality just to get any damage in.
Reporting for duty.
Wow, okay, so a bit conservative with it.
Mm-hmm. He has already seen one copy of Swipe, so he's not necessarily in a position where he's afraid of kind of getting a bunch of things out in the board here. But Jab looks to be...
A bunch of things will hit the board.
Yeah.
Well, Jab's game plan is to just to remove all the minions off of No Tomorrow's hand, right? I mean, it seems like No Tomorrow's kind of running out of options. His turn 4 play wasn't really that good. You know, you would expect the Shredder to be the best, but instead it's going to be Noble Sacrifice into Redemption. So Jab is going to have a good time clearing all these little minions.
Yeah, the redemption on the get down, as it's known.
From not the sound defender. Effect. Yeah, that is the proper name.
Yeah, it's going to allow. Yeah, it's not a particularly powerful effect. And we were mentioning this a little bit earlier. This is one of the weaknesses of the Mysterious Challenger deck. When you do draw so many of those secrets by themselves, they're individually not particularly powerful cards. And now, if No Tomorrow does draw his Mysterious Challenger, it's going to be a bit weaker because he has no copies of Redemption to get.
It's also considerably bad when not only do you draw quite a few secrets, but when you draw quite a few of the same secrets.
Right.
So Mysterious Challenger pulls out fewer things that you don't want to top deck from.
And you see a shake of the head from No Tomorrow as he recognizes this game is getting kind of out of reach. Jab's still at 24 health.
Six damage.
Yeah.
Right.
And look at his hand. I mean, he has a quality in Consecration, mm-hmm. but he's playing a very proactive Paladin deck, not really a reactive Paladin deck. He doesn't have as many of the late game power cards like Lay on Hands or Kel'Thuzad that you might see in the more controlling Paladin decks.
And against Jab's 8-card hand, I think Jab is in a very good position right now.
Yeah, Jab's hand, on the other hand, is a hand that he really struggles to play more than one thing each turn. So mm-hmm. I wouldn't be surprised to see the Emperor come down, even though it's not the highest tempo play.
Okay.
I think it probably results in the highest tempo over 3 turns.
It does. Immediate tempo would be the Dr. Broom, and it seems like that's what he's going to go for. Just like stick to the strategy of clearing minions as they come, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Emperor does allow Jab to play more cards. It could counter stuff like Divine Favor, perhaps. But, you know, maybe the pressure right now on the board just, you know, gets to him. 6 damage every turn is a lot of damage.
I think it might be enough to equality consecrate. I mean, you're not getting rid of that board without equality.
Mm. I wonder if you need the consecration here.
You mean just the quality?
You could possibly just play a quality, because if you quality consecration, you can't make another Silverhand recruit.
Okay. And if you quality, you can Coghammer in this case.
Yeah, you could play your Coghammer, and if you do a quality consecration, you're very likely to lose at least a couple of your minions to those boombots. Anyway.
I think you're absolutely right.
Let me think.
I think I like the quality attack into the two big minions with the recruits, and then attack the boombots with your spiders. Maybe he's just gonna try and save his quality here.
Oh, interesting. Oh wow, he's actually going to use the consecration.
Oh, he's going to use consecration
and save the equality.
But save equality, okay.
All right. Interesting.
I think he's looking at the fact that he can get some value from this consecration right now. Consecration
double four.
thankfully, they did hit things that
didn't
take too much to die anyway.
Exactly.
But the flame strike bots. Ooh, but here the Coghammer getting
innervate the Emperor.
Yeah, the Coghammer being seriously punished by that Harrison.
So
Jones.
Many cards.
That is pretty. That's a six-card Emperor. That's Freeze Mage status.
That is, and Jad actually sets up lethal with this play as well. Well, No Tomorrow does have equality. And wow, the best six drop.
That is about the best turn you could hope for. Yeah. Is clear your board, play Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah, as bad as his last few draws have been, this one really brings him back in the game.
He's still in a pretty rough spot here.
Mm-hmm. He is, but he's one Divine Favor away from winning.
It's true. He does, find that.
Well, luckily for Jab, he does have the BGH available.
More importantly, he has the Wrath, which guarantees the Avenge on the 6-6.
That's true.
Otherwise, it would be a 50-50.
Right. Mm-hmm. So you Wrath the 1-1. The Mysterious Challenger is going to get buffed by Avenge, and your Big Game Hunter can clear that off pretty easily.
Yeah, Big Game Hunter is a card that, in many cases, people typically play because Handlock was popular, thanks to the Molten and Mountain Giants. But this combination of Mysterious Challenger plus Avenge generates creatures of 7 or more power almost as frequently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have seen Paladin, particularly the Secret Paladin, be considerably more popular in today's matches than in yesterday's. Mm-hmm. So it's representing about half the field. It's just funny how it worked out in the tournament.
Yeah, and here, Jab picking up a couple more extra cards.
Yeah.
And 17 is not a comfortable life spot, but with zero cards from your opponent, it doesn't seem that bad.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
And Muster, normally pretty powerful, but we know that there's that swipe in Jab's hand. And we have to imagine those secrets from No Tomorrow.
It's lethal, right?
Well, there might be another
Noble
Sacrifice. Noble
Sacrifice, I believe, is one of those. But I think it still is lethal.
It's 14 plus 7 minus 2, so it's 19 even if it's Noble Sacrifice.
Yes, I believe you're correct. I believe he can play Force of Nature, Savage Roar, Hero Power Attack, or not even necessarily Hero Power Attack, attack with his hero,
right,
and just go for lethal damage.
Sure, makes sense.
As long as the sequencing is correct,
No Tomorrow just concedes. So Jab takes the first game in this elimination match with his Druid deck.
Yeah, pretty good stuff. That's a face of confidence. You don't see that too frequently on Jab, but I'm glad to see it. I like to
he
see people when they're like in the zone, you know.
there's a
special kind of look that people have when they're like in the zone.
The glare in the eyes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Jab is a player who's pretty reserved. Mm-hmm. You know, we hear his interviews, and he's never like, I'm going to win. He's just like, I feel pretty confident. I've prepared well. And, you know, he definitely here, though, you see that look of resolve there. He doesn't want to go home.
Right. There is a lot on the line. It is double elimination, so the first game is maybe a little bit less pressure. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to the end, you know... Not today.
Yeah. No tomorrow, I mean.
Oh, maybe it is No Tomorrow.
Oh, man.
And here it is No Tomorrow who is at risk of not having a tomorrow in this tournament. He, mm-hmm. Down a game here. Jab, what do you think about how these lineups, Jabs against No Tomorrows, they really pan out?
Well, the Druid from Jab being, checked off is actually really, really decent because No Tomorrow does run Hunter, does run Paladin, and it seems like, you know, Jab kind of stole that win away. So I would definitely give the advantage to Jab because sometimes even when you're up a game, you might not be a big favorite
because
of how the matchups work. That's kind of how Conquest is kind of interesting. Mm-hmm.
I think that Jab's two decks here both have pretty good matchups down the line against mm-hmm. No Tomorrow. I really like his Tempo Mage deck here. It's very strong against Druid, also quite strong against Paladin, thanks to Flamewaker being able to wipe out all of the Muster for Battletoads.
Sure, I just really like his Tempo Mage
deck. Oh, yeah, I think I've
just
been really impressed.
Without any words after it.
No, absolutely. I Of the decks in this event, that's the one that has probably impressed me the most. We watched it a couple weeks ago at the America's Championship as well, where Jab finished in the top four, obviously, to make his way here. And that was, I think, his strongest deck at that event as well.
Well, of course, Jab is not much of a stranger when it comes to tournaments. And in fact, he has had a little bit of history in regards to missing a final in the past. Let's hear about that.
I think the moment I qualified for this tournament was the happiest point of my Hearthstone career so far, because last year I made it to regionals as well and just fell short, so it's good to be able to finally achieve this. Since I was so close last year, I knew for sure that I could improve and then finally get to where I wanted to be as a player.
All right, well, yeah, this time he made it, but oh man, it's getting close to exiting again. But
well, good start.
Yeah, he's made it one step further,
right.
And I think more than anything, just being on this world stage, showing people that you know you're playing really cool decks, you're playing really well. Often, even if you don't end up winning, even if that happens to be the case, I think you win the heart of some of the people watching. And I think things like he's done with some of his decks, especially his mage deck, has done a lot to accomplish that goal at least.
But you still want to win.
You still want to
win. At the end of the day, it's about winning.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, all these players here definitely want to go to BlizzCon, play on that stage, and come home with the trophy. Jab certainly among them. And now he's going to be playing the deck that, well, it might not be the one that we've been most excited to see, the one he's most known for, which is his Hunter deck.
Right. Now, he didn't have much luck with his Hunter deck. It seems like he outpaces opponents in the first few turns, but being a mid-range Hunter, he really just has to win the mid-range. And it just so happened that he kept facing other decks with better mid-range, even though that seems unlikely. It kept on happening against his opening game today. And, well, that's why he's here, unfortunately, in the first elimination match.
Yeah, this is a pretty good start from Jab here, getting the Mad Scientist killed by the Noble Sacrifice, allowing him to set up this Freezing Trap, which can protect Knife Juggler, which is a very strong card in this matchup.
Right, yeah. And with the interesting thing is the Secret Paladin, it's like all in on turn two or three, right? Mm-hmm. So here, if you're Note to Mars, it's like, okay, yeah, I saw a couple Freeze Traps earlier, but maybe there was another trap, and I think I have to hope that it's something else right now.
Yeah.
I think he has to play the Juggler and go for the kill in the unlikely scenario that that's the case.
Yeah, I agree with that.
It's also not like the Freeze Trap's getting worse.
Mm-hmm.
There is the possibility that it's not Freeze Trap, which we know it is.
Yeah, unfortunately. And there is no Eagle Horn to buff up the durability of it, so it's better to proc the trap right now anyways.
And the competitive spirit, one of the weaker secrets that Notomar could play onto this board. And Jab has to be thinking about exactly what this secret could be, though. We know that it's competitive spirit, but if this is, for instance, Noble Sacrifice, Jab would be much less inclined to attack his Knife Juggler into his opponent's Knife Juggler.
I think at this stage in the game, you're really just going through... Oh, that's pretty cool. I think you're really just going through the cards to try to guarantee a good curve. This is a rare case. Like, you often think of, like, one or two turns ahead. But this is one of those cases where you think really, really far ahead. Because you need to play the Hymen on 6. You need to play the Dr. Boom on 7. So any card that's less mana than that, you need to be able to play on curve before it. Or it comes down on turn 8 or later, which is usually a stage where the game has already finished.
Yeah, and here, Jab must be kind of wishing he had traded. He just got both those minions consecrated away and left No Tomorrow with this buffed up Knife Juggler.
Yeah, and forced to play the Hellmaster with Valhalla Beast to get buffed just so he can play something. I think that was pretty important, but not the best play of this.
Had he traded the Knife Jugglers for one another, it would have been a different case where the Huffer would have likely survived.
Yeah.
I mean, why would you consecrate just one Huffer? I mean, you might, because he didn't have many options.
But right. If you did, at least the Juggler would be gone.
Exactly.
So.
But in that case, you would have had even a candidate for your Houndmaster, which would have been a pretty big deal.
Yeah, though it's also possible that rather than being competitive spirit, that secret was redemption.
Mm-hmm.
And in that case, you know, Jab really would have been very happy to attack the way he did. So the way that it played out exactly ended up just not working out for Jab.
Mm-hmm. I think we see another example of just using a card because you need to play on curve.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you just use Unleash for two hounds against a Secret Paladin, which floods the board every other turn.
Yeah.
But it's still the best play, like, pretty clearly, because if you're not doing it now, you're doing it on turn 8, and turn 8 is just too late for anything.
Yeah. Actually, effectively utilizing your mana is very important, mm-hmm. particularly in games between decks that are both pretty aggressive, and that if you just try and maximize the value you get out of each of your cards, you can just end up dying with them in your hand.
Right. You basically always die with them, actually, with that strategy. That's absolutely cool. Well, Redemption, an interesting choice here. He has the bigger board. He's probably hoping that Jab doesn't have a huge power play this turn so he can continue going for face damage. But as it happens, Jab has a pretty good card on turn 6.
I will point that at your face.
That was like that was the fastest attack I've ever seen.
Well, No Tomorrow has the King's Divine Favor play, which is pretty good, but I mean, do you really want to keep going face at this stage?
The thing is, even if he goes face, if he's gonna be dead to that kill command if that Savannah Highmane is allowed to actually attack.
Mm-hmm. And like, if you kill
right
Savannah Highmane, it's just gonna spawn more
right,
hyenas.
Yeah,
he can't deal with it. He can prevent lethal by double attacking, then consecrating, then divine favoring.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
But that doesn't
seem like something I would do from his side of the board.
No, you also just put yourself in a position there where, you know, yes, you don't die to exactly kill command, but you're gonna be losing to something else mm-hmm. down the line. Right. You're not getting enough damage in. Your opponent still has a minion that is on the board, and you could get that.
Or you could get a Kobold Geomancer for the Svelva damage buff.
Or Thalnos.
Exactly.
Looks like
he's going
for it, though. He's gonna.
Oh, that's good.
That actually is not bad.
That's interesting.
There is some synergy there. It's true.
Well, if Jab cannot close out this game, we're going to see a similar situation as some of the games he's had in the last few rounds, where he has such a dominating performance in the first few turns, but he starts kind of being edged out in the late game. I don't think that's going to be the case. It's still looking really well
right.
for him, but he cannot end the game right away, can he?
That Eaglehorn Bow is a really important draw for Jab. It lets him get in damage right now. Because right now, Jab has the ability to do 6 damage mm-hmm. on board plus his hero power. Mm-hmm. Adding the bow, that becomes 9 damage, which puts No Tomorrow down within kill command hero power range. So if he just played Dr. Boom this turn and No Tomorrow played something like Mysterious Challenger, it's possible that he's able to clear things off and not lose. But Jab can put No Tomorrow in a situation where he is mm-hmm. under a ton of pressure to have to win next turn.
Oh, wow.
Looks like he is choosing to go with Dr. Boom, though.
Yeah, I do like the Eaglehorn bow that you said, Kibler, because it does guarantee that you have lethal. But seems like that Jab is going to go the more safer route and do a little bit of more board control-ish
play. It is pretty safe. Actually, with that play, a true silver draw would not end up in being lethal.
That's true. That is true. So here, this is a little bit of an awkward spot for No Tomorrow as well. He can play the Mysterious Challenger. I mean, I guess he wants to trade it to the boombox here.
Yeah, if you have a Noble Sacrifice still up, definitely, right?
Secret Keeper's higher tempo than the guy, and this game is over very soon.
The Eaglehorn Bow may actually still just close things out, because the Eaglehorn Bow in Jab's hand will allow him to trigger the Noble Sacrifice.
And it's gone.
Yeah, it's gone. All right, so let's see if Eaglehorn Bow.
I believe this is lethal, right?
I think it was
already lethal though. Eaglehorn Bow triggers the.
Wasn't exactly
mysterious
lethal.
Challenger.
It was actually 1 damage off.
Was it?
Was it?
Yeah.
You might be right.
Yeah.
So
the quick shot.
Yeah, the quick shot was actually
the
key
with
draw.
The
right.
Exactly.
Right. No, you're absolutely right.
Quick shot draw was actually lethal. Very good for Jab. He gets lucky.
Yeah. I mean, we did just see Mal'Ganis off the top.
Yeah.
You know, right. Pretty much knock him out of his last game. So
seems like
one good draw deserves another.
Out in Jab's world.
In the long run, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. In the longer run.
Yeah, he needed that. He needed that
he needed
quick shot
right
to actually close things out for sure.
There we go.
And it is exactly lethal. Jab takes a 2-0 lead.
And that
against
was, that
No
was
Tomorrow.
Really quite a close game. It was going to the wire. It really did feel like Dr. Boom was a little bit of a risky play, but hey, if you win, you win, right?
Well, it was a play that prevented his opponent from potentially presenting lethal mm-hmm. next turn mm-hmm. by eliminating his opponent's minion rather than attacking his opponent's face and using his resources to play that bow as well.
Right. Well, no, tomorrow is quite behind here. I think out of the dominant performances we've seen in the tournament, Jab's Casino Mage has actually done just that.
It is.
And no tomorrow, he has to beat it three times.
Mm-hmm. Pretty hard to beat, like, unstable portals three times. Yeah. You know, it has to get something good eventually.
with as much fun as it is to see that deck play, I'm hoping that if Jab does take it, that Notamar at least grabs a couple games before it, you know?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, just so for entertainment value, we want to see some cool stuff happen.
for your entertainment, not for theirs.
Well,
I imagine the Jab.
The way
just
the
next
work
one.
Is often the entertainment value comes at a price of the players.
Okay,
just in the general sense, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You see them sweating.
Exactly.
Oh, dear, what's happening now?
That does make Crip happy.
Yeah.
He did say that, you know, this is his favorite part, the elimination, and someone has to go home.
All right. Well, no tomorrow is certainly not eliminated yet. It is absolutely possible that in Hearthstone, winning three games in a row against anything, there's always that chance. There's always the chance that no tomorrow goes all the way. And he had a few thoughts to share with us about what he would do if he would end up winning.
That
was a fun little comment.
As a recently married man, I can appreciate that.
I like food, so I think I'm cheering a little
he
bit for
no tomorrow.
He sold
you with tomorrow. The first one.
Yeah, both parts of that.
Second
parts
one.
Of that.
All right. Well, he does have to have quite a comeback here to be in contention to win. To save himself from elimination, he has to go through Jab's fairly dominant Casino Mage with Hunter, with Druid, and with Paladin. It's kind of fun. I mean, it's something that we analyzed in the first moments of the tournament is how a lot of players are just bringing what they think the three best decks are, and other players are just bringing three decks that I wouldn't even say are not necessarily the best, are literally not the best, but they specifically target a type of archetype, and they just deny the win. Now, as a tournament player yourself, I asked Kibler a little bit, what do you think about this aspect? Which one would you go with if you were in their shoes?
Well, you do have to predict a little bit of what players are going to think. You do want to be the odd one out, right? If everybody's playing the field, the best three decks, then countering all the best three decks is just natural, right? But then if everybody's trying to counter, then you just want to, you know, just go natural because they're just going to have less of a power curve. So always going the other way seems to be, you know, a champion's way to victory.
So it's just predicting whether more people will play the strong ones or more people will do the counters?
Exactly. If you're going that, or you can just play your best classes. It always works out well.
It is also important to keep in mind that you need to play what you're familiar with. You need to play what you're comfortable with. In many cases, players will say, oh, this is the best deck, I'll play the best deck. But if you're not familiar with it, if you don't recognize the different lines of play and what's important in any given game, you're giving up a lot of value right there.
All right, well, not playing any spells there. Turns out is going to be a bit punished here. It's going to be much slower to dish out this hand as it otherwise would have been with the Sorcerer Apprentice in play.
Yeah, this is a tough start from Jab here.
It's a horrible start.
Oh, my.
And this is the downside of the spell-heavy mage deck here. It can definitely get hands where you need to. Here he's using multiple spells to deal with just a 2-drop.
Yeah.
But he obviously wants to pair these with something like Flame Waker that gives it a lot more value to each of them. But when you are playing a synergy-based deck, sometimes those synergies just don't manifest.
Yeah,
well, Sorcerer Apprentice was a pretty good synergy. It's just that usually Sorcerer Apprentice with a barrage of spells is usually strong in order to protect the smaller minion before it.
And here is synergy, Huffer and Face.
Oh, wow.
He found it.
Vanish versus Flame Strike.
Flame Strike, that's a pretty strong one. Though No Tomorrow is playing a very aggressive Hunter deck. Against which a card like Flame Strike isn't nearly as effective.
Actually, Vanish is actually pretty decent.
Yeah, it could actually
save
be
your
pretty
minions
good later
and then
on.
Charge again later.
Yeah. I mean, if your opponent has minions that wouldn't otherwise die to Flame Strike, if you Vanish them, it buys you an extra turn.
Oh, it's a better conceal.
Yeah.
It costs six times more.
Well,
that's the difference.
There's downsides and upsides to certain cards in Hearthstone.
Okay. Huffer gets to charge again.
That's not Huffer.
Yeah,
that's
a smaller one.
This is, we've seen a sort of split on the charge minions that different players have chosen to use in their Hunter decks. We've actually seen all three of the different three cost ones: Argent Horse Rider, Wolf Rider, and Arcane Golem. Here, that Wolf Rider did get in for 3 damage, but it immediately died to a hero power. So that's one of the situations where maybe the Argent Horse Rider would have been a little stronger.
Yeah, dealt that extra one. Yeah. All right, well, he plays the Abusive Sergeant in order to attempt to play around Mirror Entity. Goes with the trap to follow, and Counterspell is revealed.
It ends up working out pretty well for No Tomorrow there. Explosive Trap, certainly the least effective of the spells in his hand at what he's looking to do this game, which is just get his opponent dead.
Mm-hmm. Right. Now, the funny thing about the Vanish is because it costs so much and does so little, it nullifies the effect of the Quick Shot.
It is a little awkward.
Spell Slinger counters Quick Shot, guys.
We did see Hot Form get the Tree of Life earlier.
Right.
I have to imagine that Jab wouldn't have been unhappy to get one of those in this game.
All right, we'll see an Effigy draw. Effigy is another just very fun card to see. I mean, people always talk about how there's this RNG element that some people in the Hearthstone community really dislike, especially about tournaments. But while I kind of understand from the competitive level, sometimes you know you don't want to see the outcome of a match based on like a boom bot. But as a viewer, I think generally it's kind of an entertaining experience, as long as it doesn't happen too often. And I think where we're at right now is a pretty reasonable spot.
Effigy is probably the most fun I have with any card in Hearthstone. whether it's getting, you know, Aviana off of a Malagos, along with the duplicate, just nuking my opponent's entire board and their face. It's glorious. The card's just glorious.
All right. Well, it seems that there really isn't much to be done from the mage here.
Look at what might just happen. He can play Dr. Boom. No Tomorrow can vanish it and just hero power him to death over two turns. This may very well be the clutch vanish to get Dr. Boom off the board.
Or he can just kill his opponent.
I wanted to see, you know, I wanted to create a moment with vanish here, but sadly, Jab just died.
Just died.
Well, fortunately, we will get to see some more of this deck.
Oh, that's exactly what you wanted.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jab still has two chances to win with the mage deck, so he's absolutely favored here. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
It was kind of a problem that Jab didn't really draw his Flame Wakers and just drew like 5 spells at one point. Yeah.
It feels like the Hunter, especially the Face Hunter, can do pretty well against the Mage, specifically if the Mage has trouble drawing enough minions, which is exactly what we saw there. Like, the more steamrolling, the more, like, the win more type of Mage deck, it seems that more and more spells are being added to the deck at the price of creatures. Mm-hmm. But in the end, if you can't get those creatures for repetitive damage, you're not really able to accomplish anything in the game.
It's very difficult to win with Arcane Blasts and Arcane Missiles alone.
Yeah. Yeah, certainly. Unless you have Malagos.
I was going to say the exact same thing. You beat me to it.
All right. Well, here, is there really any preference if you're No Tomorrow? You've kind of struggled with Paladin twice already. Maybe it's a fresh start with the Druid, even though that maybe is a slightly worse matchup against Mage.
It does depend on your perspective and your mentality. If you're looking to try and build up momentum, if you want to play I think his Paladin deck is probably the one that has the better chance of winning. I think Druid is the class that is punished the most by the Tempo Mage deck with things like Mirror Entity and just the fast start that's capable of. If he wants to try and just get a game with the Paladin and then have Jab maybe sort of mentally reeling from being down from up 2-0 to an even series, that would be the direction he would go. He might just want to just get this over with, and if I lose, I lose.
Well, I absolutely agree with that aggressive mentality, and No Tomorrow has talked about that a little bit. He's talked about how he definitely likes to play the aggressive style. So let's hear a little bit about that before we get into our next game.
因为我比赞通常我最开始打比赛的时候，当时我第一次参加炉石比赛，然后夺得冠军，在那场比赛中，我打的就是非常的比较有侵略性以及打法很快，而且我喜欢那时候并不知道规则，我喜欢打一些发一些抱歉啊，抱歉的之类的话语，然后的话
，My apologies。
比赛的时候动作也很摇摆，就是喜欢到处乱动。 喜欢在动来动去这样的，像听的有 DJ 一样，音乐一样。
Well, that's just an awesome, awesome statement there. Now, speaking about sorry emotes, it is something that sometimes can be aggravating to see your opponent use, especially repeatedly in some cases, as is the case. But I'm kind of curious. Do you guys have like a favorite character? Do you guys have a favorite sorry?
My favorite emotes by far are all in Magni.
Yeah.
Oh, so sorry, friend.
Are,
so
you took that from me.
I mean, I love
him. I have to agree with that. I'm so sorry, friend.
Yeah, he sounds really legitimate too. Right?
Yeah,
he's really sorry.
Yeah. So many of them they sound kind of sarcastic.
And yeah.
I think that's why people sort of perceive, oh, you said sorry, you're a big jerk. But with Magni, it's like, oh no, he sounds so sincere. How could I possibly be mad at him?
What about you, Amaz? Do you have any dissent to Magni being king of the emotes?
Yeah, he's okay.
King of Kazadan and emotes.
Gul'dan sorry is definitely the best one.
Okay.
Yeah. He sounds so wicked when he says it.
All right, well, speaking of wicked, the Mana Worm here with the coin and a bunch of one-drop spells and Flame Waker. Holy cow, this looks bad, but it's true.
That is a very powerful draw from Jab. We were saying earlier, you know, the difference between having Mana Worm and not is enormous, and this is a draw that really maximizes that Mana Worm.
Oh, my.
Oh, this is really scary if Nochimote decides to play the Shredder.
This is so scary, I think you actually need to Wrath one of those.
Or do you swipe the Flame Waker?
That seems a bit weird. I kind of like the Wrath Darnassus more than I'd like a swipe.
Well, the thing is, like, if you swipe now, you can, you know, do Darnassus Wrath next turn. Whereas if you Wrath here, you can't swipe and Darnassus next turn. So yeah, swiping here does kind of utilize mana a little bit better that way. Kind of weird way to do that.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, Spellslinger right on time.
Dead or alive.
Betrayal. We will see if No Tomorrow plays around Betrayal.
That's really difficult to do.
I don't think so. But actually, as an arena player, it's something you have like ingrained into your mind. Whenever you have a stealth minion, you always, always play it in the middle.
Sure, but when you play against Rogue, right?
How do you like his Cone of Cold positioning?
No. When you play against everything.
Everything.
Yeah, I'm telling you, it's
oh, man.
Like, I get people tell me all the time, it's like, oh, so you're playing against Betrayal from a Druid. Is that right?
Oh.
I'm like, yes.
Okay.
Yes,
so that's what I'm doing. The skill cap in Hearthstone is actually really, really high.
And artificial in some cases.
It's pretty hilarious that both players have the card, the positioning cards you have to play around. Mm-hmm. You actually see Betrayal on one side and Cone of Cold on the other. It's like, oh, nice Cone of Cold positioning.
Yeah. And Cone of Cold is actually a really powerful card if you're leading to a combo turn, the more I think about it.
Yeah, no, it actually could come up pretty big in this game. That's one of the really cool things about Spellslinger is you do see, you know, players put into these situations where they have to use cards they might not necessarily.
Wow, look at that power play.
Oh yeah, but is that Betrayal positioning good?
Oh no, he can get so wrecked
actually,
by Betrayal.
Actually, it is. Yeah, I think the worst Betrayal positioning is the 5-2 in the middle because the Mana Worm just kills it.
Okay. Makes sense.
Here it is.
If all your minions die to Betrayal, you want powerful one in the middle.
Yeah.
That's the idea.
All right, makes sense. Wow, you really, you know, theorycraft about this a lot.
You do get Betrayal in arena. It's not that uncommon.
Okay.
Shadowboxer will not die to either of those arcane blasts.
Well, a little bit of help they might.
Yeah, there is the arcane missiles as well. He could potentially fire off arcane missiles, arcane blast what's left over.
Mm-hmm.
But then he just gets Cone of Colded. Looks like he may just go with the Frostbolt, though. Guaranteed kill for just the one card.
And looks like he's really valuing that face damage. And I don't blame him. He's winning.
Yeah.
When you're winning, you want to be attacking face. You want your opponent to have to trade to play defensively.
We do have two Wraths for No Tomorrow here, though, that he could potentially use to take out both of those Mana Worms, potentially. He also has the Cone of Cold. He could potentially attack it and trade here. What if that was a...
Whoa!
Oh, my. Oh dear, that is really something.
That is really something.
It's really good.
He can actually just cast his entire hand. Can't
yeah.
He?
Yeah. The only thing better than that would have been a spell damage minion, I think.
Yeah. That's true. but these wraths become mortal coils now. Then you don't have to kill the thing to draw a card.
Better mortal coil then.
Yeah.
That's a pre-nerf Shiv. Remember that one?
Oh man, Shiv was good. But Shiv is still in the game.
Yeah, but Shiv costs twice as much mana as it used to.
That's true.
This is a huge, huge turn from No Tomorrow with that Cone of Cold. I suppose getting wrecked by Betrayal, then wrecking back with Cone of Cold off the same Spellslinger is only fair.
It's not fair when one person gets the Totemic Might, you know?
And there's Dr. Boom, but not time just yet. Jab's still at 6 mana. I think we're going to see.
I think you just
this.
Play everything because it's the same scenario. You're playing Boom next turn. You want to play everything else now before it so you get the absolute most tempo.
Yeah.
Oh, it looks like he does save the Arcane Blast, though.
Well, this Mana Worm already contests the board, right? It already kills an Ancient of Lore, so that's really, really powerful.
Mm-hmm. Actually, if you play an Ancient of Lore, you would not trade.
Yeah, you just go phase.
Oh, you just go phase.
So the damage is relevant, actually.
Oh, that's true.
Arcane Blast, Arcane Blast, and then Arcane Missiles would be more aggressive, at least.
Okay, I see. You're just pushing that one extra damage.
Hmm. No, it's two from the Arcane Missiles plus one buff from the Mana Worm.
Oh, yeah, you're right, because the Arcane Missiles would have hit
the
minions.
And the Mana Worm attacks twice, so it's actually four extra damage.
Okay. We'll see if that matters in the end.
It's possible you don't actually get the additional attack with the Mana Worm if there's a removal effect, but...
Well, you only removal Savage Roar, which counts as attacking twice.
Well, in this particular hand, yes.
Keeper of the Grove is still not drawn yet,
right?
Yeah.
I mean, No Tomorrow did just play both his copies of Wrath last turn, so there aren't that many efficient ways he could deal with that. So this is a really rough spot for No Tomorrow.
Are you going to heal?
No, you have to draw cards.
His hand is too bad to not draw cards.
Keeper was just one card away. So now he has to deal with a Dr. Broom.
Ooh, Mirror Entity.
Face.
Not really exactly what he's looking for here.
Face the place?
If you just tried Fireball, the game would have been over. But yeah, I think if you're in this position, you just... Well, maybe not.
Well, you could trade. I mean, Savage Roar would kill the Dr. Boom if he does leave the Keeper of the Grove... the lore up, I mean.
Yeah, but if he does that, he's basically dead. Because the Druid takes another five. He'll be at two. And then there's two Boom Bots.
Oh, so you're assuming the Boom Bots do a lot of damage.
No, even if they do one damage.
Do they ever not do a lot of damage? Oh, Big Game Hunter. And this is a pretty great turn for No Tomorrow here. He's still under a ton of pressure, though. The Keeper clears off the Mana Worm. Big Game Hunter takes out Dr. Boom. But these Boom Bots
can still be lethal.
Yeah, so do you clear Boom Bot here? Oh, wow. Does he have lethal next turn with the Drew of the Claw and Savage Roar?
I believe he might if
that's really scary.
Jab is not able to close up this game here.
Oh, Shredder.
Well, how do you want to utilize this Arcane Blast? Well, that one seems pretty good now.
You could use an Arcane Blast right now and guarantee more damage on the face, maybe? Oh, it goes to the face anyways.
Play everything out.
So, how much damage is this? Oh, he does use the Arcane Blast.
Yeah, it's not close to lethal.
No.
Yeah, now he's lost all resources.
Yeah, 9+6 only. And there's a Mirror Entity, and that's gonna help a lot.
Actually, it seems like he's in big trouble if he actually just plays a creature.
Right. Well, you have to play the Shade before, because Shade is the weaker creature.
No, I don't know if it is. I think the Charging Druid of the Claw is the weaker creature, because the Shade can't be attacked, so you have to attack the Shredder and hope bad things come out.
Well, you want the taunt creature, right? You want the taunt creature so the Shredder doesn't hit your face.
Right. Yeah, I think what he wants to do is play the Shade, give Jab a Shade, make it a taunted bear.
This game is really close.
Yeah,
you'd have to go face here.
Yep. Yeah, No Tomorrow needs
If Jab gets a good draw here, he can seal out the game.
Yep. Something like a spell would do, and...
That's not it. So right now, the Savage Roar is not quite lethal if the bear dies, I believe. What do you have? 8 plus 4, it's 14.
Like you. Well, Ping's still going to the face because if Jab top decks a Fireball, for example, it's lethal.
Yep. I think he would still
have lethal otherwise, right?
No, because the hero power.
Yeah.
7.
Well, he would have the hero power too.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
That's
dear.
Really clutch.
That heal here is huge. And he's just able to trade off the board. And No Tomorrow is looking like he's trying to stick around for tomorrow.
Yeah, I don't see a one card solution here that Jab would draw.
All right, even Power Blast wouldn't do.
Yeah. He goes to 11.
Could he Arcane Intellect into something?
Unstable Portal would be a good card here.
Unstable Portal into Deathwing?
Oh.
Counterspell.
That does save him.
It saves him for a turn.
Yeah. Unless No Tomorrow draws a spell.
And.
Ooh. That's not quite enough.
I think you would just play Savage Roar first to see what the secret is.
Yeah.
Because that makes sense.
Yeah, you don't actually need to play Druid of the Claw. You can play like Druid of the Claw and Taunt or something.
That
and
makes sense.
You can bad news.
Cast Savage Roar and just attack face and then play Sylvanas in case your opponent unstable portals into Deathwing.
Deathwing, wow.
I'm on it, guys.
Oh,
I'm
you,
on
you
it.
Play around those edge cases, too. You guys are both very good Hearthstone players.
Unstable Portal to Deathwing. I want to see it.
Well, that was a bit of a misplay if that was going to happen. So where's the
where
Deathwing
is it?
Now?
Oh,
no, it was an effigy. It was too
we
bad.
Didn't even get to see what it was.
No Deathwing from Unstable Portal.
Oh, you saw it?
Yeah, yeah.
Never lucky.
What happens to Unstable Portal for in Jab's list this whole game?
And we actually knew that Hotform was running only one, so perhaps that is a little bit of the tech choices. I mean, it seems weird. They have all these new spells in the deck.
Sure.
And the creatures are all still there. So like, something's going somewhere.
Okay.
Right? Maybe it is. Maybe it is a one deck of Unstable Portal.
Could
I think we have seen Unstable Portal played from
yes.
Jab's deck.
Okay.
But I don't think we've seen two. And I'm thinking that maybe that's one of the things that drop. Usually, players who practice decks so much will often individually make the same meta decisions for their decks. And this might just be an example of that.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to see Deathwing, really.
I really want to see Deathwing.
That's all I wanted to see.
It's a dragon, right?
You got it, man.
Yeah
we're
you're
really
on to me.
Missing. Like, we haven't had an Unstable Portal highlight for this tournament yet. We really need one by the end.
Yeah, oh, for sure.
Do we have an effigy highlight yet?
No.
Not yet, either. Yeah. Okay,
all right, well, maybe we'll produce one here.
All right, well, going into game five, the winner of this will advance to play tomorrow, and the loser is, unfortunately for them, out of the BlizzCon Hearthstone World Championship.
All right, well, I mean, Jab has a pretty good opener again, and being able to just drop the first minion on the board is a really big deal. Oh, man. Oh, we've seen players in this situation coin out a knife juggler and lose the game instantly.
Yeah.
Looks like that's not going to be the case this time.
Mm-hmm. Notomo does recognize that a possibility of a clear with Arcane Blast or Frostbolt is pretty easy to have.
Mm-hmm.
And now Jab's turn is actually not as good. So that was a good play on Notomo's side.
Well, that's a bit interesting.
Lot of secrets from the Secret Paladin here.
Yeah, again, not what you want.
Yeah, you're hoping to maybe play one of those in the early turns, maybe two.
Mm-hmm.
But here in Notomar with four different secrets, he's able to, if he wants, play that Knife Juggler with Redemption up protected.
I just like the Knife Juggler here because Frostbolt doesn't cut it. He really needs exactly Arcane Blast or the better half of the RNG on Arcane Missiles.
Sure.
So even though we know it's going to get pretty wrecked here, I think it's absolutely the correct play.
Yeah, unfortunately for Notomorrow, Jab does have the Arcane Blast. We've seen this card come up really big in a lot of Jab's games. Mm-hmm. Exactly this reason, that just the sheer efficiency of the one-cost removal effect here allowing him to take out the Knife Juggler and preserve his Mana Worm on the board.
Yeah, it's not just play like
your God. Oh, we see a shake of the head from Notomorrow, who is really not happy with this situation.
I mean, if you could pick, like, the worst cards to draw, you would have picked quite a few of these.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, indeed. Even Consecrate is not doing anything.
No.
So Jab is, I imagine attacking here, he's looking to potentially play around a Redemption, another Redemption.
I think he just wants to play a Secret.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately here, he may commit to a ping to keep his Mana Worm alive, which just seems kind of bad. You don't want to play Effigy. You don't really want to play Counterspell because he has so many secrets. You want to play Counterspell kind of when he's spent a lot of his hand.
Right.
So maybe you could hit like a Divine Favor or a Kings, like the more clunky cards that usually are at the end of a hand rather than the start.
He certainly doesn't want to get an Effigy onto this board at the moment either.
Mm-hmm.
Like Effigy on a one drop is just not very powerful.
Right.
He'd love to play Flame Waker, but Flame Waker, when his opponent has a minion up, is very vulnerable to a possibility of Blessing of Kings.
Right. I think that might still be the best play though. I think you kind of just have to say, you know, if he has this, I'll lose, but if I play too passively, I'll lose anyway.
Well, the thing is that you kind of want to balance between minions and spells, just in case, you know, one of them gets removed. So I would actually prefer, you know, just pinging off the creature here, or even playing a secret, for example. And keep the Flame Waker when you actually cast a spell along with it for guaranteed value.
And there's Muster for Battle, which is going to be pretty strong for Notomorrow here. Allows him to play Avenge as well. So this is
a terrific Avenge as well.
Yeah, no, this is a good spot for that Avenge because the Flame Waker will be able to take down some of these.
The Avenge will proc before the Flame Waker shoots the missiles. So this
does
is
it?
Not a clear board.
It does. It will buff the guy. Now this will be able to potentially take out that Flame Waker.
That's still good, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Tyrion, wow. Actually, if he draws Mysterious Challenger next turn, it's going to be Mysterious Challenger into Tyrion.
Yeah, for a five secret starting hand, No Tomorrow is actually doing all right.
Well, this is true. Jab is having the same problem we saw him have in the previous game, where he just didn't have any minions. He has a bunch of spells in his hand. The secrets in your deck are about the last things you want to draw. You really want to just get those off of your mad scientists. And now, Jab really, he is getting to the mid game without anything in play. And it's called Tempo Mage for a reason. You want to have a presence on the board.
Earth Shock.
Oh no! Demon Fuse.
And Jab with the actual unplayable Demon Fuse.
No, he's got Effigy up. What are you talking about? There's a demon in there.
He can also Unstable Portal into a demon.
Oh,
right. These are the possibilities.
And that's why you run Unstable Portal along with Spellslinger, because you might get Totemic Might, but Totem Golem is going to save the day.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, we actually did see
we
Totemic
Might. We did see Totemic Might, yeah.
The synergy.
Okay, well, no great draw for turn six for No Tomorrow, but it definitely could be worse. Muster for Battle isn't a horrible play. It just seems like because you can't tackle the board well enough, you just have to go for face, hope for the best, and maybe consecrate to clear a later time.
Mm-hmm. That makes
sense. No Tomorrow's got to be afraid of a couple of things. One being, he'd love to be able to play a minion this turn in case that's Mirror Entity on Jab's side of the board, because he really wants to coin that Tyrion out. But it's a super scary proposition. Go with Earth Shock.
Oh, no, it's
trying to play around Counterspell. Not Counterspell. So now, he has the opportunity to use his Muster for Battle, knowing that it's going to resolve and give him his minions.
Such an aggressive attack.
Yeah.
I feel like you kind of have to expect that the mage is running out of stuff constantly. So giving him a little bit of an easier time to burn you down is something that could go wrong. Really wrong.
Yeah, sure. But you do have the Noble Sacrifice up, so that attack does kind of make sense.
Oh, I see. You're right, you're right.
Okay, Frostbolt does clear the Avenged Recruit. And
you still don't want to Counterspell because the coin hasn't been played yet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, generally you want to hold the Counterspell until after your opponent has played the coin when they are the second player. Here, though, we know that countering the coin could be a pretty big deal because it stops Tyrion from coming back next day.
Yeah.
So this
it's also the fact that there's two secrets up, so Tomorrow might just not play Tyrion.
Right, it's a very good chance he just casts this Haunted Creeper right now.
Nope.
Oh.
All right.
Will it not work?
Well, if he does choose to clear off this...
This is the best case here. Two-drop demon that stays alive.
Two-drop demon.
Succubus.
Succubus. Or
Mistress of Pain.
Mistress of Pain is the second
Mistress
one?
Of Pain,
Mistress of Pain with
awesome.
Demon Fuse would be great.
Oh. Yeah, it would.
And giving your opponent one mana crystal here doesn't really matter too much, right?
I think it has to be Succubus, though, because you have...
You need to be able to get
you
through Tyrion,
You have a lot of
too.
Issues with Tyrion.
Yeah.
Okay. So you just want to deal as much damage as you possibly can.
All right.
Rather than heal up.
So No Tomorrow, I have to wonder if he's debating, okay, do I want to clear this off? Do I want to just go for face damage here?
Reporting for duty.
Yeah, Arcane Elect would punish leaving the Sorcerer's Apprentice up, but no, he's just going to take the risk of that.
I'm a little surprised by this choice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is a pretty dangerous card, but when you see just two cards, you might not be as threatened.
But now, we are getting to the late stages of the game, where here is Tyrion Fordring. Or as the golden version, Tyrion Morbling, I'm told.
Wow. I have not been told that, but I'm glad I've been passed on
now
information.
You know. Now you know. That's his official title.
Wow. Blizzard is making great things happen.
Oh,
Mana Worm, not what you want here. It's a great card in your opening hand, not a great card to draw on turn 9.
It's also a card you really don't want to effigy, but it seems that your opponent is just ignoring your effigy play regardless, so you kind of just have to go for it.
It's kind of like a snake trap, right? You'd never want to block it.
Right.
So he's able to take down Tyrion, but that weapon is still a big threat, especially with how much damage No Tomorrow actually has to play.
Is No Tomorrow scared of lethal, perhaps, from Jab's side?
Mm-hmm.
He knows there's one card from Spellslinger. It's pretty unlikely that it is a burn effect.
It could be Moonfire.
It could be Starfire.
What do you like here? I feel like
I do think
the weapon into the 2-3 and then just dumping your hand with Consecrate.
Which of
the interesting?
Yeah, I like actually potentially just consecrating, attacking the 1-2 into the 4-3. and then casting consecration,
or and maybe then you effigy a two drop.
You're right.
One
well,
drop.
You're gonna effigy a two drop anyway because you're effigying them.
No, you effigy the man.
Oh, if you attack with your weapon, sure.
Yeah.
I think the five damage is worth keeping around. Like you want to go five in the face this turn.
Oh no, demon.
Nope.
Never lucky.
Not a demon.
So let's see if Notomura wants to kill more creatures here, because there is 7 damage on the board, which is 8 damage on the board with the hero card.
Yeah, I feel like you have to get these minions off the board. It's just so much safer. You want to send the weapon at face. It, even though you do have this competitive spirit, which is extremely attractive, you don't want to let Drab draw a fireball beat you.
Nope, just still dash the fireball though.
He left the shredder up.
Yeah.
Jab throws fireball, he wins the game.
And is it gonna be fireball?
Right?
It's fireball! Oh! It's fireball! Oh!
That was the only one left.
Oh my god!
Is he fireball
this game,
Tyrion?
This game is over! Jab, the top deck fireball,
man.
It got Jab past Trump, and no tomorrow. Oh my god, it is down.
Did
it? It is
clear
over.
The shredder.
That does it.
That was incredible. That, wow.
No tomorrow is our first player to be eliminated, and Jab continues on. Jab's dream is alive.
That is
wow,
that's
that was so surprising.
Yeah, Jab in the America's Championship was one turn away from elimination at the hands of Trump. He drew Spellslinger and Track into Fireball. Now he is one game away from elimination here, and he just draws the Miracle Fireball when his opponent leaves
it's
the four
power
minions
on the board.
Very
similar situation, I believe, where lethal could have been prevented.
Yeah.
In this case, it wouldn't have been.
It's not guaranteed.
Guaranteed.
It's not guaranteed.
Guaranteed.
It could have been Milhouse.
Any demon would have done it.
Yeah, it's true. Any demon would have still won the game.
Right.
But
a couple.
Wow.
Yeah. Pretty surprising. All right. Well, Jab is ready for his winner's interview, and I'm sure he is really glad that he's in that room right now. So let's hear from that and Rachel.
Hey, Jab. That was a heck of a last turn there. What did it feel like to get Fireball in your hand there?
I wasn't really expecting to win that game, so that was very surprising. Feels good, I guess.
Now, you were ahead too early on, and No Tomorrow almost was able to take it back. What would you do a little differently now that you had some time to think about it?
I think I played as well as I could have. Not much I'm going to change up for my coming matches. I just need to keep focusing, and hopefully I get lucky. Like, my spell slingers were pretty bad, but I got rewarded in the end with a fireball draw, so that felt good.
Well, you have a lot of NA fans cheering for you, a lot of USA fans in chat. I want to know, you're working really hard on building your stream audience. You have a lot of viewers out there. Is there anything you want to say to them?
Thanks for cheering me on. Hopefully I can make it to BlizzCon and hopefully win the whole thing as well. That'd be awesome.
Well, good luck to you, Jab, and good luck to you, Jab boys in chat as well. I'm going to give it back to our casters.
Well, winning BlizzCon is definitely awesome,
yeah,
as he puts
it. I'm seriously, my heart is still actually kind of racing for that. And I'm just sitting here on the desk, you know.
It seems so unlikely, like 5 seconds before
we were just
he ended
like,
up closing the game.
Looks like Jab's done, and then it's, you know, nope, leave the 4-1 up, fireball. Crazy stuff.
Yeah, crazy stuff indeed. And again, guys, that was the first of our elimination rounds. We have 3 more super exciting, super tense matches that so much is on the line. For 6 of these players. Before we get into those, though, just like to thank our sponsors for making the event happen, making everything work so you guys can have this awesome viewing experience. And before we get into our next match, let's have a quick look at some of the stuff we just saw, some of the highlights from our last few games, and of course, brought to you by Windows 10 Game DVR.